Anyways, today we are going to conclude our series we've been in, which is looking at healthy living while we live in a toxic society. And the one thing I've been stressing is this: we live in a culture that is constantly trying to get us to engage in behaviors and activities and environments that are toxic to us spiritually, that will kill us spiritually. And as we continue to put these toxic things in our lives, our spiritual lives start to just nosedive. And we start to feel further and further away from God, and we feel like we're more and more disconnected from God. And the reason for that is because these toxins from our culture and things that we have put into our lives kind of build a wall between us and God, all right? And so we're talking about, how can we get back to healthy living? How can we detox from those things and kind of strip that wall back down so we can get a clear picture of God again in our lives and start to experience the life that God desires for us to experience, rather than just feeling like garbage all the time because of the toxins that are built up in our system. So in the first week, if you remember, we talked about toxic language. And we looked at language that we use that's bad for us and actually bad for the people around us as well. And we looked at the scripture of Psalms 141:3 that just said, "Take control of what I say, O Lord, and guard my lips." Okay? The second week, we looked at toxic fears and the fears that we hold inside that prevent us from doing the things God calls us to do. And we looked at the scripture of Psalms 27:1 that just says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Why should I be afraid?" Week three, we looked at toxic relationships that we can have in our lives. And we looked at not how we can avoid them, but how we can have a positive influence in those relationships and hopefully try to help them as we help ourselves as well. And we looked at Proverbs 12:26. It said, "The godly give good advice to their friends." Then last week, we looked at toxic thoughts that we have in our lives that drive our behavior. Not the thoughts we think every day, but the thoughts that sit in the back of our head that actually dictate how we behave on a daily basis. And we looked at Philippians 4:13 that just said, "For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength." Okay? Today, to wrap everything up, we're going to look at cultural toxins that surround us in our everyday lives that we live with every single day. Now, to be honest with you, this is a very tough topic to know where to even begin, because everything the Bible teaches us is totally countercultural to everything we're used to experiencing on a daily basis, all right? The world says to do A, and in almost every situation, God tells us to do B. Have you found that out, Christians? Really? I mean, just about everything the world tells you to do and is acceptable and is good, the Bible and God's telling you, no, avoid that and do opposite. Do a totally opposite thing. So it's very hard to know where you begin, because I could easily get up here this morning and make the case that the Amish have it right. Okay? I could. Here's an Amish guy. Put the picture up. Where is he? Is he coming? There we go. I can make the case they have it figured out, and we don't as Christians. I could read you a couple of scriptures. Let me read you one. Romans 12:2. Don't copy the customs and behaviors of this world. Okay? I could read you Proverbs 4:14-15. It says this: "Don't do as the wicked do, and don't follow the paths of evildoers. Don't even think about it. Don't go that way. Turn away and keep moving." I could make the case the Amish have it figured out by reading scriptures to you. They do make good food, though. Okay? Their food's delicious. So the chicken and the mashed potatoes and noodles, you know I don't like food in general, but man, the Amish, they might convince me to be Amish just because of their food. But here's the thing. I can make the case outside of their food that the Amish have it right. But here's the deal. If I did that, I would also put us at conflict with the scriptures that tell us we need to go into all the world and preach the good news. And I would be in conflict that we need to be the light of the world. Okay? So obviously I would say this. The Amish, I don't think, have it right because they have isolated themselves from the world. God never calls us to be isolated from the world. Now, one of the things you will see Christians do in today's church is this. We start to think, you know what? Our culture is drastically different than the culture the early church was dealing with and the Roman society they were dealing with 2,000 years ago. So the things we read in the Bible don't really apply to us today. And there's a lot of Christians who are thinking this today, which is when you read these scriptures, they were things that applied to the early church living in the Roman culture, but 2,000 years later, we live in America, and we don't deal with the same things. But here's what I think you'd be surprised about, is the culture we live in and the culture of ancient Rome that the early church found itself in, that the scriptures were written to, are very similar. I would even make this case. of all the cultures who have ever been on this face of this planet since the Roman Empire, we are the closest to them in our lifestyles and what happens in our culture. Let me tell you some things that are extremely similar between the ancient Roman culture of 2,000 years ago and American culture today. Here's some of the things. First one is this, sexuality gone wrong. If you have any sense right now, you know this in our culture, that the way of sexuality is viewed in our culture is completely against everything God views sexuality to be, okay? Sexuality in God's eyes is this, a husband and a wife, and they live in a marriage, and that's the only place sex takes place, is in a marriage relationship. That's a scriptural command, okay? In Roman times, they did not have pornography that you could log on to and watch on video all the time, okay? They didn't have that, and you go, so we're not like them. But understand what they did have. They had temples with prostitutes all over them that people just went and had sex with prostitutes. They had male and female prostitutes in these temples. They'd usually put them on hills so everybody in the city could see you going up to them. And it was something that was prevalent in the society, in the streets, all around. Sexuality and the perversion of sexuality was everywhere in ancient Rome, the same way it is in our culture today. Okay? Very similar. We have abortion today. So we abort babies, which looks nice, and it's not as gory as what they used to do. But understand what the Romans did, which was prevalent back then. They didn't abort babies. But what they would do is if you didn't want your baby, you would have your baby, and then you would stick it in a jar. And then you would either go stick it on the curb, and maybe somebody would take it, or it would die, and then they would clean it, and they would take care of it for you. Or you could go to fields where you could put it in the field and walk away. And their reasoning for that was this: I don't feel guilty because I didn't really kill the baby. The baby died under its own conditions, and it wasn't my fault. Okay? But that was prevalent in the Roman Empire. That's how they did it back then. We just do it so it looks a little nicer, which is we kill them before they come out. But it was the same cultural things happening in their culture. The next thing here, entertainment for pleasure. Roman Empire, you know this, with the Colosseum and the entertainment and the plays and all that type of stuff. They were one of the first societies to actually have enough extra time to go entertain themselves and just go entertain for pleasure's sake, like we do, okay? Now you look and go, well, they were doing stuff in the Colosseum and we do what we do. Let's be honest. The Colosseum, they would go and they would reinvent war battles that had happened that people couldn't see, and they would reinvent them, and they'd actually have people killing each other in war battles, and they would take Christians at times and stick them out and have lions and stuff eat them and all that, and you go, that's not us. What movies have you seen recently? Okay? How many war movies have you seen? How many of you saw Private Ryan? Is that really a whole lot different than what Rome was doing? They showing you what war takes place and all that. I'm just saying, we entertain ourselves with things just like the Romans did. The Romans had very sexually explicit plays that they would go to and entertain themselves at. No different than what our people do with some of the movies we go see, some of the TV shows we watch. Very similar cultures. They're not drastically different other than some of the technology means of how we deliver it to ourselves. Okay? The next one, the pursuit of wealth and stuff above all else. Roman Empire, extremely wealthy. Most of what the known world knew as humankind, they were extremely wealthy, and the people who pursued things and owning things and having things and building big houses and bigger houses and accumulating things, and they were the first society where you had the middle class even doing that, which is what we do. It is the pursuit of wealth above all else. We'll put everything else to pursue wealth and to get bigger and better things. We'll put the livelihoods of others aside. We will put the caring for others aside if it means we can advance ourselves and get more stuff. That was the Roman Empire, the same thing they were doing. The last one, break down a family structure. We look at our society and go, divorce is prevalent in our society. Guess what? It was in Rome too. Okay, in Rome it was the same thing. You wanted to divorce your husband or wife. They didn't really have formal marriages. So since you didn't have any type of formal marriage, you could easily break them up. And all you had to do is kind of stand before people and say, I'm divorcing that person. Or write a simple letter saying, I'm divorcing those people. And you had divorces rampant in Rome, just like you do in our culture. The reason I tell you this stuff, I want you to understand the stuff written in the Bible was written to a church living in the same society we live in. It's just as relevant to us as it was to them. Let me read you a passage. 2 Timothy chapter 3. The Apostle Paul describes their culture. And you tell me if this sounds like our culture. Okay, here we go. Here's what he says. He says, for people will love only themselves and their money. How many of you would say that describes our society to some degree? And you see that, okay? He goes on. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents. I just don't want to do that. And ungrateful. How many of you see that in our society? Okay? They will consider nothing sacred. How many of you see that in our society? Okay? They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others, and they will have no self-control. Okay? They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. This was written 2,000 years ago by Paul to the early church, going, here's what your society is going to look like, and this is what your society is 2,000 years ago. And it's spot on. I can read it today and go, that describes us, does it not? So to say we live in a different culture, we don't. The words in the Bible and what their intent was to the early church are the same things they were intended for us, and to live by the same way the early church was supposed to live by. Context and environment and time has not changed what God was trying to teach his people, how they were to live their lives. Now, here's the problem. We live in a culture that is completely toxic to our spiritual well-being, and God calls us to live counter to that culture. He calls us to live different than that culture. In 1 John chapter 2, it says this, do not love this world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love this world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. Let me reread that passage to you and think about your own life and the things that drive us. He says, for the world offers only the cravings of physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. I know a lot of people, that's what their entire life is about. That's a perfect description of everything that motivates them. I know a lot of people that way. All right? Then he wraps it up. He says this, these are not from the Father, but are from this world. Okay? Here's the problem we have. Now, this comment, these passages, almost seem overwhelming to us. Because growing up in a society, when we become Christians, all we know is toxic things surrounding us in the culture that we live in. That's all we know, because that's all we've experienced. So you can read this passage and go, that is overwhelming. I don't even know what to do with it, because to start following that means living a whole life I don't even know. I can't even comprehend it because it's so foreign to me. Now, what typically happens, though, in a church, and you've seen this happen in churches, they read that scripture up on the screen, and what you start having is you have people in the church that start judging each other and the behaviors they have and the things they're participating in, so that they can start making a spiritual pecking order. And you've probably seen this in churches before, where I will look over here at Rick and Vicky, and I will hear Rick and Vicky did something that I don't think they should probably do, and I want Rick and Vicky to know they shouldn't have done that, and the reason they should have done that is God doesn't approve of that. And the real reason I'm doing that is it makes me feel better because I know I'm better than them. You ever seen that happen in church before? And churches start doing this to each other and start judging each other because everybody has their own standard of what's acceptable, what's not acceptable. And we go around judging each other. And what you will find in a church that happens, when that starts to happen, is it leads to a complete fracturing of the church family. And it blows up the family environment of the church. The other thing that you will notice that starts to happen is you start having that church become isolated more and more from the world. Because the way they view it is, if you live like the world, you can't be in here with us. You need to live totally different. The way you're living right now, that's not acceptable to us, and you're not really acceptable here. So some churches will go, we need to put like a dress code up on the front doors, so when you come up to the church, we can read the dress code to know if you're acceptable or not. Or we can put behaviors up on the doors, so when you come to the church, you can know if you're acceptable or not, because they want you to know God calls us to live a different standard. If you're going to be here among us, you better live up to the standard that we have created. And what happens in these churches is there's two things that get lost: grace and love. And you can walk into those churches and you will not feel any love and you will not feel any grace. And all you will feel is judgment. And that's what will happen in churches that get lost in this whole thing of we are going to define what is right and what is wrong. So the question this morning is this. What do we do? What do we do? Do I just give you a list of things that the leadership and I agree are correct behaviors and wrong behaviors? Should we write up something and go, these are the movies that are acceptable, these are movies that are not, these are the things that are behaviors that you can do, and these are the things you shouldn't do? As Christians, here's the thing. Like you, I think there's very few of us that would agree that's a good thing to do in the church. And I would also say this, who's the one who gets to design that list? Because no matter who designs that list, is flawed in the first place, so it's going to be flawed. Okay? So obviously, that's not the route to go. So here's what we're going to do instead this morning. Instead of focusing on all the wrong things that we involve ourselves in, what we're going to talk about this morning is this. What are some healthy things we can add to our lives? Okay, a lot of times we tend to get caught up on going, let's evaluate all the bad things in our lives and figure out how we get rid of those things. And I'm going to go a different direction this morning because I don't think that's real effective. The direction I want to hit on is, what are some good things you can add to your life? Of Philippians 4, it says this, and now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. It says, fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all the things you learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing, then the God of peace will be with you. Okay? What you see in this passage is Paul basically comes out and he says, what you need to do, you need to start thinking on some positive things. Think on good things. Think on godly things. Add those things to your life. And the reason I think he says this is this. The way I said it is this. What you feed will grow. I've just got a picture of a plant I'm going to put up here. What you feed will grow. Which plant's been fed well up there? The one on your right or the one on your left? Okay, we all know this. It's easy. We can leave that picture and go, oh, the one on the right's the one that's been fed well. The other one's the one that's been neglected. In your life, what you feed will grow. If you feed the good things in your life, that will begin to grow in your life. If you feed the negative things in your life and the unhealthy things in your life, that will grow in your life. You got to understand, all Christians who grow spiritually, they grow by feeding the good stuff in their life, and that good stuff eventually matures them and helps them to remove the bad stuff. But I think a lot of times we get into a problem with viewing this is, being a Christian is about removing bad stuff from your life. I have this issue that I just read the scripture and it just tells me this is bad, I gotta remove this thing, but your heart never changes. And what your faith becomes is a checklist of things you have to remove and just get rid of and try to keep them boxed away somewhere so they don't come back into your life. But your heart never changes. The thing about that is it doesn't make you grow spiritually. You're not getting healthier. You're just getting rid of some bad things that you're boxing up and sticking away. But you're not getting healthier. The way you get healthy, and most Christians know this, is you add more and more health to your life. And as you add more and more health to your life, your mind starts to change and your heart starts to change. And the things you once desired aren't desirable anymore. Would you agree with me, those of you that are longtime Christians? The things you once desired because of the influence of the Holy Spirit in your life and the growth of His influence in your life, the things you once desired aren't desirable anymore. I used to say this. This is one of the weird things. I worked with a minister at my last place, and I remember I used to tell my mom this and my dad this all the time. This is when I'd sit with him, and I knew this guy well. My dad went to school with him and all. We were at this church, leading a large church, and over time, I remember, because I knew him since a child and everything like that, me and him had this relationship and we had talked. And we would talk in his office and he would always talk about how he felt like he's in prison being a minister because he couldn't go drink like he wanted to and he couldn't go involve himself in this and he felt like he's in a prison and he just wished he could get out of it sometime and just go indulge in those things. I remember telling my mom and my dad, being a non-believer until I was 20 and doing a lot of that stuff, I remember going, I've never once, since getting rid of some of those things in my life, ever had a desire to go back to those things. And I don't understand it. I don't understand why this guy wants, like, desires those things. Like, I just don't have those desires in my life. I have no desire to go back to that lifestyle. I don't feel trapped. I feel like I've been liberated. I have no desires for it. And what it was is I saw a guy, now that I think back, going, he was this guy that just felt like I'm trying to not do these things. But he wasn't filling himself up with healthy things that made a change in his heart to go, but I don't desire them anymore. Okay? who I am at 41 is totally different than who I was when I was a baby Christian at 21. Okay? The way I live my life now looks drastically different. Not because I, like, have good, self-control to stop doing some bad things I know are bad. That didn't work. Those things always continually pop back up in my life. You know what worked? Is the Holy Spirit more presence in my life over time, that my desires went away. And those things change. So that's what I want to talk about today, is I want to talk about what you feed will grow. Now, in Romans 5, we get a hint of this. Or Romans chapter 8, it says this. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about simple things. But those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death. He says, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life and peace. Things we all desire. To find life and peace. What you feed will grow. So we need to work on feeding the Holy Spirit in our lives rather than our corrupt worldly spirits. We've got to start feeding a different organism in us. If we feed the Holy Spirit in our lives, what will happen is His influence will grow and grow and grow within us. And over time, we will start to look countercultural because our desires have changed and we will look different from the world. Not because we read a scripture and went, I just got to remove those things. Because I fed the presence of the Holy Spirit in my life. So, what I want to do this morning is this. I want to simply give you just six practical ways can feed the Spirit. Okay? Six very practical ways you can feed the Spirit. You have them on the front of your program, so you have them. Let me give you what they are. The first one, I would highly encourage you, and just so you know this morning, if you do one of these, what I'm going to ask you by the end of the time here today is pick a new one to add to what you're already doing. If you don't do any of these, just pick one. Don't pick all six. All six will overwhelm you too much. Pick one, okay, and add it to your life and start feeding the Spirit. First one is this. If you don't do this now, read your Bible, okay? If you don't have a Bible, there's no reason you shouldn't. You can download it on your phone anywhere, get the Bible app, you have Bibles, okay? I don't have a paper Bible anymore. My Bible's on my tablet, my phone, everything else. It's where I don't own a paper Bible anymore. But you need to be reading your Bible. Now, if you're sitting there going, I'm going to start in the front of the book, don't, please, don't, okay? Let me give you three books that I'd highly encourage you to start with and a good way to read them. These are my three favorites in the Bible. I think they're on the front of your program, right? Do I have James, Proverbs, and Matthew? Okay. These are my three favorite books because they're straightforward. If you read James, there's no guessing of what he's saying. You don't have to know cultural context. You don't have to know background a whole lot to read what he says and figure out what he's saying, okay? Some of the other books of the Bible, you can get lost in some because if you don't know the cultural context, who's writing it, who it's being written to, you can get lost at times in it. The book of James is very hard to get lost. It's just like the straight shooter who comes before you and tells you the truth right to your face, and you're like, ooh, that was kind of brash or a little bold. That's what James does. But it's very good to read if you haven't read the Bible before to go, I understand what he's saying. Short book as well. I think it's 5-6 chapters, okay? The other two I would highly encourage, Proverbs. It's a book of wisdom. What you could do is, if you don't read your Bible right now, I think there's 31 chapters of that. You can take one chapter a day per month, and you can read the whole book in a month. It's Old Testament. Look in your table of contents for Proverbs. And it's just little witty sayings about how to live your life. It's not like overwhelming God, God, God. The first several chapters are to some degree, but then it's godly wisdom of how to be successful in this life and how to make good decisions. Great book to read. Another one I'd highly encourage is Matthew. First book in the New Testament. If you want to know specifically about Jesus and his life and what he did, read the book of Matthew. It's pretty easy to understand. It gives you Jesus' life, what his teachings were and his core teachings, and you get a good feel for him reading Matthew. Again, it's like 28 chapters, so you're talking one chapter a day. Take you 5-10 minutes tops. 10 minutes if you put a little thought into it and think about what you're reading. It's not overwhelming, but it's a little something you can do to start feeding the Holy Spirit in your life. Okay? The Word of God, guarantee you, feeds the Holy Spirit in your life and helps it grow in your life. All right? Second thing I would recommend, maybe you do Bible reading right now, or maybe, let me say, if you don't read the Bible regularly right now, start with the Bible, skip the other five. Okay? The other five are secondary things. The Bible's the meat. okay? So start there. If you read the Bible fairly regularly right now, here's the other list of things I've done. Get a Christian book. Go out, find a Christian book somewhere, and just start reading a Christian book at work when you have a break, or at home in the morning or in the evening or something. Read a chapter a day or 4 or 5 pages a day or something. Go find a Christian book. Most of them are decent. There's bad ones out there, but I can't tell you what all of them are. Most of them are decent. Go find one that you think is going to be interesting. Read it. It will start to feed the Holy Spirit. It gets you thinking about spiritual things, and that's good for you, and that's feeding the Spirit in your life. Another thing you can do, attend church regularly. Give a little caution with this one. Attend a good church regularly. Okay? Let me say this. If you came here 5 years ago, I would highly encourage you to come back. Just being honest with you. Those that have attended through here, that's fine. You can be mad at me, whatever you want. All I can tell you is, why would I bring people in here to face the same garbage they face in the world inside this church building? The gossip, the slander, the people yapping all the time. Why would I do that to someone? I will say this. This church that we have today is wonderful. The atmosphere here, you guys are wonderful. Are you perfect? No. No. Am I perfect? Well, no. No. I'm one of the leaders here, and you put me up on stage, so this is what you're seeing every week. None of us are normal, and none of us are perfect. But I will say this. You guys love each other. You care for each other. You don't sit there trying to hurt each other. That's not part of our DNA anymore. It's beautiful. I can tell you from a leadership side, those of us who are in leadership and have seen both, it's nice to lead this church now, is it not? It's nice to show up to leadership meetings and laugh together, have a good time together, joke with each other, insult each other, have fun, and walk away having a good night, rather than showing up and having issue after issue after issue where we're just... So when I say attend church, find a good church to attend with good godly people where it's a positive environment, and go there and attend there. Because it will uplift your spirits, and it will feed the Holy Spirit in your life, because you will hear the word of God, and you will be around God's people, and that can only be beneficial to you. It's why God told you to be in the church, and why God created the church. Okay? So one of the things I tell you, if you read your Bible regularly, but you only attend church maybe twice a month, make an effort for the next month to attend 4 straight weeks. Okay? It will be an encouragement to you. It will be encouragement to the other people here. Attending church is something you can do to feed the Holy Spirit in your life. Let me give you 3 more. Attend Christian entertainment. If you like this, there's Christian concerts. There's Christian movies. This is not an area I enjoy. I don't do any of these, but I'm telling you, some of you might. The Christian movies that are out there, they're getting better and better. The reason I don't typically like them, I grew up in like the 80s when I was... They would show me these films that always told me I was going to hell and I'm going to die tonight, and if you don't accept Christ, you're going to die. And I was like, forget these people. I want nothing to do with you. So those are the ones we saw as a kid. But today, there's actually good ones. Where's Becky? Is Becky in here? Becky. Becky always knows what good Christian movie is coming out. So if you ever have a question, go see Becky. Because I think Becky sees every good Christian movie that comes out. Do you not, Becky? And she takes some of the ladies with her and stuff, too. So if you ever have a question, go see Becky. And Becky will tell you, like, that wasn't really a good one. It wasn't that good. But she'll tell you all the ones that are really good, okay? So see Becky if you need a movie advisor to go find some good Christian movies. There's Christian entertainers that come in. It's one of the beautiful things in our culture today. They'll come into BOK Center and everything else of all these music groups that you can go to a Christian concert. I've never been to a concert in my life, so I don't know what it feels like. But some of you have. You can go to a Christian concert. They're uplifting. They're positive. They feed the Holy Spirit, okay? That's something you can do. Two more. Listen to Christian radio. How many of you listen to either 94.1 or 105.7? That's about half of you. Okay? Listen to Christian music on your way to work, on your way home from work. It's great music. Okay? I read the Bible well. Most of the rest of the things I don't do well. So that one, okay? I listen to secular music, but I have my son who's an avid Christian music station, and he's like a dictator in my car. So anytime we're in our car, he always turns off my music, and he turns on to 94.1 and 105.7. So he's like the positive light in my life. And so I hear the Christian music and go, that's actually good stuff, okay? It feeds the Holy Spirit. Listen to Christian radio. Last one I suggest to you is this. Find an answer to a spiritual question that you have. And you go, what does that mean? Let me tell you what that means. A lot of you have spiritual questions running around in your head. Most of the time to get the answer, you go find me. Or someone else you think has a lot more knowledge than you. You go find them to find the answer to your question. And I tell you, the easiest way to grow in your spiritual life biblically, go find out the answer yourself. You'll grow. Where's Jim? Jim Steele. Jim, teaching Wednesday nights. Do you grow now more than you have in a long time because you have to lead a lesson and teach? Yes. Why? Because he's got to go find answers. I don't sit down with Jim and tell Jim, here's what you're all going to do. Jim gets a topic, and then Jim has to go find the answers to it, and he has to teach on it. Jim does a lot of research. He grows. If you have a biblical question, feel free to come talk to me. That's why we are here. That's why elders are here and stuff like that. But what I suggest you, too, you got the internet access and all now. Go to it, find the answer and research it, and you'll learn a ton. And it will feed the Holy Spirit in your life. Okay, here's what I want you to do today. Is I want you to pick one thing off that list of six. You've got your program. I want you to circle one that you make a commitment for the next month. You're going to start adding that to your life. Just add that thing to your life. It's your choice, your pick. What I encourage you, if you want the Holy Spirit's presence to grow in your life, pick one of those six things, just add it to your life. They're not super hard. They're not super time-consuming. They are something that will start to feed the Spirit, and the Spirit will start to grow in your life. Remember, what you feed will grow. Here's what you have to understand. We are surrounded by a toxic culture that feeds that part of us every single day, whether we want it to or not. It does. We need to have something that's countering that. Okay? That's where you need to add some of these things. I want to close this morning. Read one passage here, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It simply says this. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. The new life has begun. Understand, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, today you are a new person. The day you accepted Christ into your life, you became a new person. The old person's gone. The old person's dead. You can keep feeding that person, and it's still going to add up to death, because that person's dead. Or you can feed the new you with the Spirit's presence in your life and let that grow. And what will happen is that grows, your heart will change, and your desires will change. And over time, your life will start to look counter to the culture that we live in. And you will start to find spiritual health. Not because you just got bad things out of your life, but because you fed the Holy Spirit and you changed your heart and your desires. That's how true growth comes.